Our interview methods are as follows. Jerry Mason invited elders for the University of Winnipeg. The University of Winnipeg students introduced themselves. Elders were offered tobacco and gifts. Elders signed video, photo, audio release forms. Elders were asked questions related to food. Elders offered other comments. Elders' responses were recorded on video and audio for later analysis and to generate recommendations. We asked elders a number of questions and they provided responses. The first question was, what are the varieties and types of foods consumed in the past and are still consumed today?
I still love my wild food. You know, I could eat fish 3 times a day. I had fish for breakfast, fish for lunch, fish for supper. You know, we had white fish, lake trout, and pickerel, and jackfish. Jackfish were the easiest fish to catch. You could catch the rod, you know, you could catch lots of jackfish. I don't eat too much fried stuff myself. I boil my fish. Like one time, my grandson gets up early in the morning, about 6 o'clock. I said, Noah, why are you up so early? Get back to bed, it's too early for you. And then, no, come, he says, I'm hungry. I said, okay, he would have cornflakes. He said, no, I don't want cornflakes. And so what do you want to eat? I want to eat fish, he said. I said, fish. Cook, no, I want to cook fish for breakfast. So he says to me, but I want the flat fish.
I got dillweed carrot here in the first row, and then 2 rows of beets, and then 1 row of cucumbers. Mm-hmm. I want to plant 1 row of cucumbers because they don't know when to quit growing.
I planted potatoes in the first 3 rows up to the middle there, or 2/3 of it. And I got corn at the other end of the 2 years. And the next row I got onions. I got Spanish onions the first part of it and yellow onions. And I go pick berries once in a while.
You know, but they're getting harder to find.
Yeah?
They're getting harder to find.
Remember
the pick berries and stuff, the greens and plums.
Do they choke berries too?
Yeah, I got choke berries. I planted two bushes and I learned all those things. Up towards the highway there, I got picture of bushes up there. I made my little furrow on top. That's because sometimes we get a lot of rain. It got washed out a couple of years in a row. We canned a lot of wild berries.
Because we are a fishing community, a lot of our diet is based on fish and probably moose meat is probably the top, and goose. I know a lot of people eat duck. I'm not a one to eat duck meat. I only tasted it once, but I preferred my goose. When the, you know, when the ditches would flood, mm-hmm. the fish would come up. I guess they come upstream and mat to spawn and all that. And like from Dallas, the fish would go up the creeks and into the ditches. All the way up towards our places, they would come right to our farmyard, but we would have to go down the road a little ways, and we would go with our scoop nets in the ditches and catch fish.
Yeah, we do that around.
Yeah, and my kids just loved that when they when I had my children, my uncle Archie, they always take them fishing, and they would get right in the ditch with the scoop nets, and they could feel the fish hitting their legs, and they're like yelling and trying to scoop up, and there was always lots, there was always a good, you had to know when to go, you know, because they only run for a certain time. Yeah. No, it's just from the spring flood, like after all the water, the snow melting. Sucker, jack, and pickerel, whitefish. Yeah. We don't like, nobody, I've never heard anybody to eat bass around here. You can eat jack, but I think there's a certain way that you have to cook it or prepare it, yeah. I don't think they're not as picked as much as what they used to pick long ago. They used to go with families and go picking, and the parents used to preserve and make jams and stuff like that. I mean, that's not that is what it was long ago. I think a lot of the berries are not as growing as much as what it was long ago. And you can't just walk in a bush anymore because of bears. They're not like loggers. You'd be able to go. You knew where to go. Okay. Raspberries, a lot of, I know there's family that will go to a eucalypt farm to get those berries. They make raspberries, strawberries. I take, I have a berry picking day. We usually go mid-July. We go to Selkirk, that way East Selkirk, and we go to a strawberry farm, Saskatoon farm, and we go pick berries. And that's with the elders that are still able to go get on their hands and knees and pick strawberries, or, you know, that's a little bit time consuming, but we could make a day out of it. We pack a lunch and, in the north, there is a lot of families, a lot of our people that still live off the land, and live off the land, do a lot of hunting, trapping, go to trap lines seasonal when they need to, and that is. But I guess it's that accessibility to getting fresh vegetables and having stuff like that, where it is costly. Yeah.
My dad moved us out to Madison Island because he was a fisherman. Nowadays, we do still eat some moose meat, and I know I still eat ducks. I eat a lot of fish, my favorite food. I eat a lot of, I don't eat deer meat. I don't know why I didn't like deer meat. But I do like moose meat. My children, they don't like the goose so much. Like I like eating goose, but they don't like it so much. I don't think the younger kids, I don't know how they react to the moose meat and duck thing. But I know my children didn't like the goose too much. For a while, it just seemed to die away in the reserve. You know, it just, there was hardly anybody planting gardens. Now it's sort of revitalizing again, and I think they're starting to understand the food chain that provides good food for us. You know, people are maybe liking the fresher vegetables. Like, we always had a garden. You know, everybody tried to have a garden that had big families. Like to have lots of potatoes in your cellar. You know, if you had a good piece of land, you planted a garden. And I'd love to have a garden, but I just couldn't take care of it the way I wanted to, the way I had to, you know. We had to have potatoes, carrots, they turn up corn, that kind of vegetables. We didn't go so much for lettuce or stuff like that. You know, some people would plant it, but.
What foods consumed in the past are not consumed now, and why?
Hard to find most out there. You really have to go a little further out. Gardening, some people have gardens in the community. The more smaller operations, not the bigger operations that you've seen in the past, that they needed one photo in the band office where the garden is almost like a football field. Mm-hmm. And those kind of gardens are not as common anymore. They're more just the size of a room, I guess, like the biggest. But some people do have gardens. Seems to be coming back, though, right?
I lived in the trap lines for about, I'd say about 11 months of the year. You know, I lived in a bush in a trap line. And we lived off the land. We didn't eat anything else. except the food from the bush, you know, all the fish, lots of moose meat. And around this time of the year in the spring, we had lots of muskrat to eat, you know, all those animals we ate. The stuff we had was flour and heat and salt, not even pepper, we didn't know anything about pepper. Salt and lard. The family was given the rations at a certain time of the year. But we were able to buy those things from the store that we had. To have some day store was the main store.
I did muskrat trapping myself. I knew how to trap muskrats. I knew how to trap muskrats. I knew how to trap weasels. I knew how to trap squirrels. These are small game animals, you know. I knew all that. So all those things we ate, you know, the moose meat. My favorite meat is the moose meat, you know. We fry it up. Now they go frying it up. But us, we used to smoke all our stuff there. Smoke all the moose meat, smoke all the fish, smoke all the muskrats, you know, and we ate beaver too. Beaver. We smoke all that meat, especially for the summer use it because there's so many flies in it. We used to pick up a ground and put them in a container in a bag and, you know, put them in to keep them. Because the flies stay away from the meat when you smoke it, you know, follow the wild food too much when you smoke it, it's unpopular. Yeah, that's the one we use for smoking. But you don't make a big fire, you just, you know, the smoke comes up. They make a raft of some kind and put all the things there for the moose meat and fish, smoked fish. Yeah, my older people got otters and what's the other animal called? Otter and mink, yeah, and martens, yeah. And some animals, they're not edible, eh? Like otter is not an edible animal, so is the mink, so is the weasel, and a squirrel is an edible animal. You could eat squirrel. And the seagull eggs used to be so good. Boil them. Of course, we just boil them. We never fry. Just Mariah livers we ate. We ate most of everything out of the fish, like white fish. We had some look like desserts in there, and Big Girl had fish eggs there. Yeah? We ate all those things. You know, my grandmother used to mash those fish eggs. And that was a treat for us. We used to make a bannock, mixing the fish eggs with a bannock too. And we did a salt and cook the bannock. That was a treat for us, you know. That bannock tasted different with those fish eggs. I don't know if anybody ever ate, you know, fish eggs. You know what I mean by fish eggs? Mm-hmm. There's a word for it in English. Caviar?
Yeah.
Whatever. Can't walk anymore in the bush. You know, even to go berry picking, I don't go berry picking too much. All our berries, we never preserve them. We just eat them as we pick them and take them home. We never put no sugar in nothing. We just eat them like that. All the raspberries, all the cranberries, and all the blueberries, and eye berries, strawberries, you know, everything. We used to pick all those up and we just eat them like that. Well, there's always most meat, and the meat that we preserve, eh?
Mm-hmm.
You know, even the geese, the ducks, eh? You know, there's still some more being preserved. Like, smoking is a way of our preservation long ago, eh? For me, anyways, when I live up north, Fisher River, they do lots of canning. They did lots of canning and preserving berries, you know. I moved here in 1976, but I used to come here all the time. Like, my husband is from Fisher River, and I know my mother and I used to have lots of jam reserved for all the fish, you know, moose meat, you know, in a jar. I've never done that myself. I did canning and all that, vegetables and that, but I don't do that anymore either. I don't even have a garden anymore myself. No, we never had no gardens up north, no, because I just I remember the minister and the priest used to have a garden. They have gardens. So I know Fisher River. Everybody had a garden in Fisher River. Everybody, just about everybody had a garden. I don't see that too much now. You know, everybody. My father-in-law had a big garden. My sister-in-law has a garden. My little grandson has a garden. He wanted to have a garden, so he's got a garden. Yeah. He was planting yesterday, so I don't know when he was planting. He's 9 now. So maybe 2 years or 3 years he had a garden. He was only 6 or 7 years old when he had a garden. So. Well, potatoes, carrots, onions, and beets, you know. Well, you could do cabbage and all that on lettuce, but there's too much bugs for those things, so, you know, now you really have to look for cucumbers, different cucumbers. Because we never had any running water or nothing either. We drank water from the lake all year round. At God's Lake, the water was so good, in it. You know, we just dip our cup, if we're traveling by canoe, we dip our cup in the lake and swim out of water. For me, I hardly ever ate anything, even sweet, drinks. We never knew anything about drinks, you know, just water. We ate rabbit all year round, winter and summer. You know, we were snaring rabbits all year round. And right now it's a muskrat season, so right now we'd be eating muskrats, you know, till April and May is a muskrat season.
I haven't gone for a hunt since Lear. My mother used to make jam. Both she keep berries and she'd make some jam. We had a two-story log house. And under the stairs, you know, to go up.
Yeah.
She had a pantry underneath her nest where she kept all her canning.
Mm-hmm.
She canned fish and meat too.
Well, I know, like, I didn't grow up in Fisher River. My mother was from Fisher River. But a lot of the food, our cultural foods that my mother ate, she has provided for us too growing up. You know, when she would get them from family members and that, which would be like fish. And my dad was also a hunter, so we ate a lot of deer and moose, rabbits. Growing up on a farm, we ate a lot of chickens and pork. Dad would butcher a cow occasionally, and Mom would make like sausage. So those were foods that I grew up eating, but also because dad was a hunter, we ate a lot of the hunt stuff off the land too, and Mom was also a gardener. Compared to what my mom tells us, what she ate, there are a lot of similarities in what we eat today to what they ate long ago. I remember taking my girls when they were just small, picking morels, and we were telling them they look like Christmas trees, the shape of them, but they're brown and, you know, little fancy edging, and so they were small and they were like going down, bending over, trying to look like this to see the mushrooms poke out of the ground.
We don't do that anymore.
We haven't done that for a few years. I don't know if they grow here for sure or not. But see, growing up, because my dad was a farmer, we've always had morels growing in the bushes and in the old pasture areas. There are a lot of foods that haven't been eaten in many years, and that's like muskrat, beaver, bear. Because like, if I was to look at something like that today, she said there was no way I would touch it today, eh? So. Bush chickens was eaten a lot too. Maybe seagull eggs, because I know a lot of the elders talk about, especially fishing season, go pick seagull eggs and eat seagull eggs, and that's not eaten. I don't think that's eaten today. My mom used to do the gardening. She used to do a lot of preservation. She used to preserve a lot of pickles and jams, and she would also, in spring when the fish are running in the ditches, they would catch the fish in the ditches, and they would, Mom would can them and you would let them sit for a while and it would be just like opening up a can of salmon and the bones would be just crumbly and everything.
When I was a child, what I remember is my dad, you know, they'd go hunting, they'd go trapping, and they'd go snaring. You know, in the wintertime, I mostly remember the wintertime because that's when they did a lot of that. They ate rabbits. We ate even beaver, you know. Also, of course, deer and moose. I don't remember eating elk that much. I remember eating a lot of deer, a lot of moose. But people still have to live off the land because of, you know, the change in the age of change was happening, okay? The modernization or whatever you want to call it. Also with the age of change came with the change of our lifestyle. And through the change of lifestyles also came, we start forgetting about the old ways, the hunting ways. We just hunting moose, hunting deer is what they mostly do nowadays. You know, there's not too many rabbit hunters anymore, or trappers, you know. So that age of change and how we live nowadays with the food we eat, processed food, that's all we eat nowadays, eh? And we go to the grocery store, and that's as far as we have to go to find food. Well, a lot of the foods in the past, a lot of them are still being consumed, but not to a great scale. You know, just a few of the hunters, or whatever you want to call them, hunters and gatherers. Some of them are still, but very few.
People can come and give me moose meat. I don't know if any of the younger families eat moose meat. There's not so much hunting around these days. So I know there's not, like, maybe there's one trapper in reserve, I don't even know. I know my dad used to trap, my brother used to trap, but I don't know about how.
So what would they trap?
Trap muskrat, you'd trap beaver, whatever, you know, like fisher, or if it's very scarce. Mink was a good money, it was good price. Wolverines, whatever animals that we had in Manitoba. The ones that we eat is mostly muskrat. Some people like beaver. I know my sister Mary used to cook that beaver. And it was good. It fooled my kids. They thought they were eating roast beef. They were eating beef. You know, like the sucker, red sucker, was a fish that was really good, eh? Like we could cut the head off on the tail, quite a bit of the tail, and we'd roast it and put a little bit of, say, salt pork on it, or bacon if you had, or jowls, and roast it, put pepper and salt, onions, oh, that was good. And we canned, I know myself and my mother, we canned a lot of suckers and used that for sandwiches for school lunches for our kids to use as salmon, eh? Like, it just tasted like salmon. It was good. I haven't canned that in years. But the only other food that I would wish for now is more rabbit, I guess. You know, I don't know what it is about rabbit that has changed, because I guess maybe I'm older. It doesn't really eat with me that much. Like, I used to be able to eat rabbit any time, you know. When we lived at Madison Island, we ate a lot of rabbit. But, bought you some fish, white fish. All the fish, you know, jackfish. My mother canned a lot.
like canned berries in the summer. We all had to go berry picking every summer. We picked berries, like we picked strawberries. You crawled around in the high grass, picked strawberries. We picked raspberries, we Saskatoon cranberries, whatever we they could can, they would can it, you know. So that was our dessert. We seldom had, we didn't have cake once in a while, but not so much. And my mother used to have a cow, she would melt and we'd have cream with our berries.
The challenges of revitalizing traditional foods and traditional ways of life.
My wife said when growing up in front of the house there, she said that the water was just clear. You could put your hand down right to the bottom and you could see, you could pick the rocks on the bottom of the river. But now you can't even see your foot into the water. It's just cloudy, and it used to be all kinds of ducks and all different martens and stuff like that on the ground. I don't see any of that hardly at all. Farther down the river there, well, they say the medicines are just turning black in there, like the wiki and all the stuff they put into the ground to make so the grass grows and the wheat grows and all that. And it's killing everything. Even if you see the reeds and stuff along the side, they used to be really tall, but now they're just half that size.
There's lots of change that impacted us and our traditional lifestyle that impacted us today. Why we're such a sick people. And when I say sick people, it's because a lot of our people are, diabetes is rampant in our First Nations people. And it's because of drastic changes in our diet. Too much technology today. Our kids are losing interest in going out and playing and having fun and having natural fun. And compared to being stuck in front of the TV, the computer, or on the Facebook, you know, too much technology. Technology is also taking away young parents from being parents. That happens with a lot of our young people. They lack that parenting skill because they're too caught up in what's going on Facebook and that. And it's not only technology, it's alcohol and drugs too. We have a drug policy in place here. Like all BAM employees are drug tested prior to starting their position. They have to pass a drug test before they can start their job. Mm-hmm. Once we're drug tested, we accept our jobs. We get randomly picked whenever. I could be at work. I could be at work today and I could get a phone call from the drug coordinator at 2:00 that I have to come for a drug test. I have to go. Well, within a school, it's zero tolerance. It's when they get a concern that somebody's carrying breeding drugs in the school, they'll bring the sniff dog in, and then all the offices are searched. And then that child, if somebody's caught, so they will be suspended, but the parents will be notified, and then they try to seek help for that child. Well, it's everywhere, eh?
Yeah.
The chief also wanted to get a grip on things before the other had. We voted this last year, they were trying to build a vendor on our reserve, and we voted against the majority of the community. I've never seen a turnout like that before. Because we have enough issues with drugs and alcohol already, and the impact of it on families and children. The people today are very sick people because of illnesses, contributed because of how we eat. You know, long ago our eating habits have changed from many, many, many years ago. Our people were such a healthy, strong people. It is because of how they lived and what they ate and what they had to do to survive, you know. And as time has changed. A lot of stuff has been lost and taken away because of things that are changing, like technology. You know, we don't have to walk to anybody's house to go and visit them. We pick up a phone or text them or go on Facebook. We lack physical activity big time in how our people, even with hunting, used to walk, canoe, go many miles to find game to bring back food for their families, whereas today we could drive to the grocery store.
The awful thing about that social media is the bullying that goes on in there. My grandmother, she passed away when she was 82 years old, and I was 12 years old. And she was born in the late 1800s, 1890-something. So what I know now, but I was just a child, of course, I'm not going to know. So ask her how life was when she was a child, you know, back in the late 1800s. Turn of the century, you know, how life was back for her when she was a child, when the things like, I always wonder about that. That teaches me how precious the knowledge is that our elders carry. You know, once it's gone, they're gone. Now I'll never know that. I'll never know how life was for a child back in that, back when my grandmother was a child, you know. I'll never know that. So that's why we have our elders. We gotta listen to our elders when they speak and learn as much as we can from them.
There's some young people that are still interested in staring rabbits there or trapping maybe. I don't know if there's any young people that would do that for a living nowadays. I don't think so. It's too easy out there. You can get jobs that are so less labor. You don't have to be trudging around in the deep snow and trapped in the cold winter months, you know? I don't think we'd have young people doing that kind of thing. To forage for your food. Nobody wants to leave their laptop or their the little machines that they have. I don't even know the names of all of them. My daughter's one time said, "We're going to get you a cell phone, Mom." "Why?" "Because we can't keep track of you." So I said, "Well, just learn me how to turn it on."
What could we do to improve Indigenous food use and production? People are revitalizing traditional ways such as Bob Crate's basement root cellar.
Well, we have our VLCs here already. We've had a VLC here for a number of years already. And so I don't think people are against it because it's that money generates back into our community through community activities, events. They sponsor a lot of programs. They sponsor our breakfast program at the school that I look after.
Mm-hmm.
And also a lot of our sports and rec teams are supported that way. They also support Christmas time that the students at the school get Christmas gifts. So they cost share with the VLCs, education and VLCs. Gifts for the kids at the school, at the building on the garden project, but also trying to bring it into the school to where they can have their own little box gardens and come year end, like when it's negative at the end of the school year, they take their little box home, look at whatever they plant in there, looking at a community garden. Yeah. giving people that awakening of the importance of us to going back to living off the land.
The help of the ones that listen to us, right? You guys from the university. It's all we need. The people to listen to us. If the government say they don't really listen to our leaders, they don't listen, you know, what we have to say. That's all we need, someone to listen to us and believe in what we say. To use social media in a good way, that would be one of the ways to get out there the fastest for our teachers, like Jerry, you know, like you guys mentioned, YouTube. To use that in a good way. Before, we just had verbal teachings, right? We didn't have papers and computers and everything but record.
Right.
Not like now, we can record it, so our words will live on for a long time. Long time our words will live on, you know?
What are the initiatives you are aware of that help in revitalizing Indigenous food systems?
We were never shown how to smoke fish and that, but with my children, my uncle's always taking it upon himself to teach our kids, like his family members' children, to smoke fish. He would make a few days of it where we would go to his house and he'd go catch fish in a ditch. He'd show the kids how to cut it and spread it, and put it in a smokehouse, and prepare the smokehouse, and what kind of diamond willow to go look for to start the smoking of the thing. So that was a healthy community initiative, and that covers nutrition, looking at nourishment for our people, physical activity, ensuring that our people are physically fit, but are getting, because we have a new fitness center we just built. The evenings after hours is used a lot. Well, it gives the kids some place to go in the evening, to go hang out, to be, they could go onto the computers. They have a big gymnasium there. They have little programs that run out of the youth center.
But here at Fisher River, I see more gardens coming up. I see more people going back to planting their own food, you know. That's one of the initiatives, and it's up to the parents to teach their children, you know, how to live off the land. That's if the parents know themselves.
I think there's a lot of good things happening in the reserve, like Jerry's program is bringing it to the schools, you know, and I think there's other people that are doing. Like, I know there's another program that's trying to initiate planting. They give us elders boxes to plant whatever we can in there, you know? I think there is a lot of programs in the reserve to help our people initiate programs. I'm really proud of our leadership for letting this happen in our community. There was a community garden back, oh geez, about 20 years ago. And it was used for a couple of years, but then started to fade away. So I really commend the chief and council coming up through the years in seeing that, having that vision for our people. I think it's great. Compared to what we had to deal with from nothing, you know, no money coming to us in the reserve. Like the chief and council struggled with trying to help people with nothing. You know, we had Indian Affairs in Pegasus, but they were stationed there, but they didn't help us in many ways to what it is now, control of our own destiny. Mm-hmm. You know, it's great. And I'm glad to be able to see that in my time. And I can only see things getting better for us. The traditional coming back into our community is good, you know. Like, and I had struggles with trying to do those kind of things with the school. Like, we had struggles because it was devil worship. Like, I was told, you don't bring a drum beat to the school. You know, we weren't allowed to do that. It was devil worship. But now it's being accepted, like having a powwow. And you know, 25 years back, we wouldn't allow that. It was a devil worship. But the things are changing for the better, and they're like, so you have to start in the school and get them into that traditional teaching and what it is to be Indian, to be proud of, regardless of who you are.
Traditional teaching 1. Animals eat the medicine, so when we eat the animals, we eat the medicine, such as muskrat, moose, beaver, and rabbit.
I guess that's why our people are so healthy long ago, because they eat all that food from the animals, because animals have, they eat all the natural medicine from the water, from the bush, you know.
I grew up with my grandparents, and my grandparents were hunters, gatherers, fishermen, trappers. One of the things my grandfather spoke about while he was trapping was that the animals that he trapped, they ate the vegetation in the surrounding area, and the roots, the plant parts of the plants in the area, and when they ate the plants, we would eat the animals that he trapped, such as the beaver and the muskrat. And my grandmother would say, when we ate the animals, we were also consuming the medicines that they ate. And she also talked about how our people back in the day, they lived a long, healthy life, and she credited that to the animals and the plants that they ate.
Additional teaching 2. Wild foods taste different now, such as fish, muskrat, beaver, and rabbit.
I know the difference in the taste now, even the fish, myself, I know that taste, the difference in the taste, even the fish from Donna taste different now. The white fish that they grow, it tastes different now.
I remember muskrat when I was a kid. It was good. Like I could eat, maybe one more than one by myself. But when I moved out here in 2005, the guy gave me 2 muskrats and my wife cooked them. I couldn't even eat them. They didn't even taste, like there was no taste. So that's what a lot of the people are doing. Like they don't have a chance to go get any muskrat, or they have it, but they don't want to eat it because there's no taste in it. They just quit eating it, so.
Additional teaching 3, never live in fear, never live in doubt.
I'm a teacher at Charles Sinclair School. I actually instruct the land-based program here in Fisher River, And our program is based on our elders' knowledge. We gain an understanding of some of the traditional activities that they did back in the day. And so what I do is I use that knowledge that the elders advise us on and take the students out hunting, trapping, gathering, and some fishing. One of the things that I'm finding is that our community, our parents, and certainly our students are losing that knowledge on a daily basis. So our program tries to provide them with the skills that they're going to need to get involved with our traditional and cultural activities in the community.
What we kept saying was, like, our school is like a jail. Mm. Like, we're stuck in there for 6 hours a day.
Yeah.
And, like, we only get, like, 10-minute breaks, and we're not allowed to leave the school.
Yeah.
So it's like, whenever we go with him, it's like, we get out of the class, we get to come here, it's just, it's better. It's boring.
Yeah.
I'd rather be in his class than anything.
Ideas for change. Mentor programs. A one-on-one mentor program could be beneficial to many people living in rural communities. A mentor is someone that young people can look up to and go to when they need help. A mentor program like Jerry's land-based program would help students engage and become more comfortable around new people. A mentor is someone that could look out for someone as well as help them get through hard times. Mentors can also be from outside a particular community.
Use social media to promote language, health initiatives, gardening, traditional knowledge, environmental programs, and mentoring.
There are more students who wanted to take Jerry's class compared to the number of capacity. By having summer camp similar to Jerry's, students would get the opportunity to learn about their culture.
Grow food hydroponically, create employment, and grow safe, economically viable food all year.
Restrict technology use for everyone. Offer banned funding credits for participating in traditional and educational activities. Require band members to install and use the Drive Safely app. And a motto could be, more wild fidelity, less Wi-Fi.
Yeah.
people were eating lettuce at that time, so nowadays everybody likes lettuce for to make a salad, but at that time there was no interest in a salad. They thought cows ate that.
Thank you.